Thank you. Amen. Dominus Obisco, sequentia Sancti Evangelii, secunda Matteo. Nella tempore dixit Iesus, discipoli sui, parabola mag, sima dea trenum cedarum de sabra, abscambita et agra, quem et qui intrenit ala, abscambit et pre gaudia lirius vade, et vendit universa que habet et emita cremito. Iterem sima dea trenum cedarum, omini negociatori querendi bonas margaritas, ne venda atomo la preziosa margarita, abit et venerit omnia quae abuit et emitea. Iteram sima deus regnum cedorum, sagene misse in mare, et ex omni genere piscium congreganti, quamquam in peta eset et agentes et secos litus sedentes, et egerunt bonas in bassa, malos atom foras miserum, ficerit in consumatione seculi, exibunt angeli et separabunt malos remedia justorum, imitent eos in camino ignis, ibi erit fetus estrid ardentio, mentet existit ec omnia, dicunt ei et sia, ai diris, idio omnis scriba doctus in regno cedorum, simile te domini patri familias, qui profet tesauro sua, nova et vetera.
In the tradition of St. Louis de Montfort, let us pray a Hail Mary. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. St. Joseph, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. This Thursday, the day upon which our Lord instituted the Most Blessed Sacrament, is on this day, might be a good time to preach on the Blessed Sacrament, on this great mystery of our faith. Now, again, when it comes to the Blessed Sacrament, to the Holy Eucharist, to the Bread of Life, there seems to be a very sharp divide that was drawn in the sand, so to speak. Our Lord said, either you're going to believe this or you don't. I am the bread of life, and if you can't take that, and if you can't eat my flesh and drink my blood, if you were to walk away, I will let you go. Which is what he did. You read in John chapter 6, where he says in the bread of life discourse, I am the bread of life. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood shall have life within me, and I will be in him. When we have these words of our Lord, when we see just how serious he was with the Blessed Sacrament, and we see the people essentially saying, I'm just paraphrasing slightly, that's gross. We don't want that. That doesn't make sense. Why would we have to eat your flesh? That sounds revolting to human ears. And when our Lord said, eat my flesh is meat indeed, my blood is drink indeed, they got the impression that he was advocating cannibalism. And even the Romans, later on in their persecution, when they talked about these Christians that follow away, they practice a certain amount of cannibalism. They must be eating children or something, because they say that they eat flesh and drink blood. That was what even the Romans thought. They had no idea about this sacred mystery. Now, our Lord obviously does not appear in the appearance of flesh and blood, but under the appearance of bread and wine. How can you tell that our Lord is there? How can you tell that our Lord is truly present? As we, when we take the kids receiving First Communion for the first time, before that we take them back to the sacristy, we show them an unconsecrated host. This is what it looks like before it gets consecrated. Do you know what it looks like when it's consecrated? And you scratch their head, maybe they might blurt out the answer, but essentially the answer is, it looks the same as right now. It doesn't look any different. It doesn't taste any different. It doesn't weigh any different. There are no measures that you can observe with our senses that our Lord is here. But our faith tells us that he is here. As you hear in the Pange Lingua, that St. Thomas penned, where our senses are defective, sensuum defectui, where our senses are defective, we cannot tell, it's our faith that is able to discern. It's only our faith that's able to see the difference. Because when our Lord says, I am the bread of life, when he says, this is my body, this is my blood, he wasn't kidding. And when he says this, he is so intent on making sure that you understand it is the literal sense of what he is saying, that he allows some to go away and no longer follow him. Now, this is a big deal when it comes to the Blessed Sacrament. And if you were to trace all these little breakaway groups that came away from the church, breakaway groups is a nice word, we'll call them heretics if they deny the Blessed Sacrament, but we'll call them breakaway groups to be nice, okay? So these breakaway groups, who all break away, at some point or another, they deny the Blessed Sacrament. They deny the true presence. It's almost a universal thing. They maybe start out here and there with some other thing. King Henry VIII wanted to have another wife to give him man-child, and when that man-child didn't come, then he gets himself another wife, and so on and so forth, till death do us part, so off with their head, repeat, repeat, repeat. Now, at the beginning, King Henry VIII did not deny the true presence, but if you look at the church that he founded that broke away, can you find them? Well, first of all, they don't have valid orders. But even if they did, all those people out there that do not believe anything is happening in the Mass. Now, obviously, they're not ordained priests, so nothing is happening. But that belief in the true presence was completely destroyed in the church. So bit by bit, if you look at the those that break away from the church, at the end of the day, the Blessed Sacrament is at the root and the foundation of one of the things that they reject. And if we look carefully, those who are great saints, those who rise to the heights of sanctity, they've got a couple things with them. One of the greatest attributes, you would say, is a true devotion to our Lord and the Blessed Sacrament. Anytime they pass by the church, they can't help but stop and pray for a while. Anytime they get to receive our Lord, they have such great joy in their hearts. Some saints could not receive our Lord without tears of joy, as they knew their Savior was coming into their souls. To know that Christ our Lord cares about us so much, he didn't want to stay up in heaven, all distant and unreachable. You got to pray to him if you want to talk to him. And yes, perhaps our Lord hears us. But, you know, in terms of the tangible, we are still human at the end of the day. And to be able to talk to our Lord up there in the clouds is a very distant thing. He still hears, this to be true. But to know you can come into his house, into the church, to kneel, this little light over here burning, telling you that Christ is present in the tabernacle, to whisper prayers to God incarnate, who is here, body, blood, soul, and divinity, in the Blessed Sacrament. That is an awesome privilege, to be able to come to the Mass, to be able to see our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament. That alone would be worth coming to the Church. But how about if God cares so much about you that he wants to come and dwell in your midst, within you? Imagine the great privilege to be in a similar category to our Blessed Mother. She carried our Lord within her for 9 months. You get a similar privilege. You get to carry our Lord within you. For as long as those accidents of bread and wine remain, Christ is present, body, blood, soul, and divinity. What an awesome privilege this is. And lest we think that God will only be with us so long as the accidents are truly there. So sacramentally, theologically speaking, as long as those accidents of bread and wine are there, we still have the accidents, those attributes of the bread, then our Lord is sacramentally present. But if we ask him to remain, stay with us, Lord, because you know how tough this world is. Stay with us, Lord. Stay with me. You know how weak I am. You know how much those temptations buffet me like the wind blows that weed in the one of those little trees. There's a strong gust, is a chance it might blow over. You know how weak I am, O Lord, so stay with me. Stay with me this whole day. Don't just stay with me for a little while. Be my guest. Stay in my heart for the whole day. Stay with me throughout the whole week. Don't leave me alone, because you know how weak I am. And our Lord listens to our prayers. Do you think after such a heartfelt prayer, our Lord would say, too late, I'm going? He wouldn't. He would stay. So when we receive our Lord in Holy Communion, this is a true gift from heaven. This is the manna that will sustain us in our journey. God himself wishes to come down to dwell in our hearts. And if we ask him to stay, then he will. And again, as we said, all the great saints, all the best of the saints, all these saints had a true devotion to our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament. It is a bit of a practice, you might say, for that heavenly destination, to be with our Lord forever in heaven. So when we receive our Lord, make sure you always pray a prayer of thanksgiving. Don't just leave the church right away. Don't just get into a conversation as soon as Mass is done. Spend that time in prayer, because there is no other time like this present that God has given you. There is no other time like having God physically within you, to have God dwelling in your heart. If you talk to him, he will listen. If you pray to him, he is there. And he is there in a very special way. May our Blessed Mother help us to pray to our Lord as she did when she carried him within her womb. And God bless you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Dominus obiscum. Ore. Depus est gratia navis tuis procede benedicite Deus.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So far